Morning. Wonderful to have all of you in worship with us today. My name is Jeremy Jacoby, senior pastor here. I'll be sharing a message from God's Word. We've got Pastor PJ here leading us in worship as well. Just a couple of things to remind you of. We don't pass our offering plates anymore, but if you want to support our ministry in that manner, you can drop offering off in the plates on your way out. But as always, you can support our ministry by giving online at our website. There's also a text to give number that comes up as well. In your worship folder, there are our prayer slips, prayer and attendance slips. If you'd fill those out, we'd appreciate it, particularly if you have a prayer request. But during the time of the children's message, ushers will come by and grab those from you, so be aware of that. If you're joining via live stream, it's great to have you join us that way as well. We'd love you to share with your family and friends that they might be blessed. I think that's it for announcements. I invite you to stand. And just as a reminder, as we begin each and every time we gather together, we remember the names into which we were baptized, and we begin again that day today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to open my eyes to see that you're shaping my life. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. All I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Cause I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will.
Amen. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you never fail us, that your love is the love that goes on and is steadfast through all generations. We take a moment, Lord, to confess our sins and those things that we have rebelled against you in our words and our thoughts and our actions. We take time to remember, Lord, how we have failed to love those around us and love our neighbors as ourselves. Not just in a worldly way of love, but Lord, with your self-sacrificial agape love that acts first and gives freely without expecting things in return. We pray that this love would transform our hearts as we look upon the way that you love us and also transform how we love those around us. that they may see you in us. Take a moment of silence to lay before the Lord those sins that burden us. Lord Jesus, we ask you to take our sins and instead give us your righteousness and peace, forgiveness. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. It is because of the love of God that he came into this world and left heaven to become flesh and become one of us, to take on our sin, to be our Savior. Because of that, I can declare to you again the forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We thank him with our next song.
Days may be darkest, but your love is greater. You light our way, God, you light our way. When evil is rising, you're rising higher, with power to save, with power to save. You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. Death had a stronghold, but your life is stronger. Rose from the grave, rose up from the grave. When evil is rising, you're rising higher, with power to save, with power to save. You keep hope alive, you keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. There's hope in the morning, hope in the evening, hope because you're living, hope because you're breathing, hope in the breaking, hope in the sorrow, hope for this moment, my hope for tomorrow. There's hope in the morning, hope in the evening, hope because you're living, hope because you're breathing. There's hope in the breaking, hope in the sorrow, hope for this moment, my hope for tomorrow.
You keep
hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive. You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive.
Amen. We'll have our kids come forward for the children's message.
Major League Baseball player. Love it. Rapper. Okay. What else? Construction guy. Awesome. What else? Janitor. Okay. What else? Work at the church. Ooh, I like that answer. You want to do what I do? I'll teach you. Okay, cool. My job, I got the replacement. All right. Well, let me ask you this. Who do you want to be as a person when you grow up? Like, what kind of person do you want to be? Do you want to be smart? Do you want to be funny? Do you want to be caring? Funny and athletic. Well, that makes sense if you want to go into Major League Baseball. What? Smart. Kind. Helpful. Kind and athletic. Okay. All right, athletic and caring and kind. What about forgiving? Should we be forgiving when we're older? Yeah, that's a good one. Okay, I have a serious question. Do you guys think I'm an adult? Thumbs up if yes, thumbs down if no. They're all going like this. Honestly, I agree with you guys. I don't feel like I'm like an adult. Like there's like adults and then there's like someone trying to pretend to be an adult. And I feel like that's my category. I even have an adultish sign that sits on my desk and says I'm an adultish, right? Because I don't feel like, I don't have it all together like most adults do. Like I make mistakes and I don't know everything, right? So I'm not like an adult. I'm glad you guys agree. I really thought everyone's gonna say I was an adult. So in our story today, we're going to talk about in the Old Testament, which was before Jesus was born, there is a guy named Jeremiah who God called to be a prophet. Who knows what a prophet is? What does a prophet do? Tells about Jesus, right? Before Jesus was born, they tell about who Jesus is, right? And how much God loved the world. Sometimes they would advise the people and say, hey, here's what God wants you to do, right? Things like that. So God tells Jeremiah, hey, you're going to be a prophet. And Jeremiah's like, whoa, are you sure? Like, I'm still pretty young. You know, if it was me in his shoes, I'd be like, there are a lot more qualified people than me to do that, like the pastors, right? Like, there's other people that should do that. And he says, no, I created you. I knew you before you were born, and I've designed you for this purpose. And he kind of does that with all of us, right? Doesn't matter who we are, how old or young we are all created in God's image, and he has called us for his purpose of sharing his love to others. So what are ways we can share his love to the world? Be kind, praying, be grateful, share the word. Yeah, being kind, being forgiving, being caring, all those things you said you wanted to do when you're older, we can actually do now, right? We can be all those things now to show God's love. So I want you to remember that this week, all right? Can you do that? Okay, let's go ahead and pray, and I'll pray for us. Dear Lord, thank you so much for loving us and help us to remember that your love is for everyone and help us to show that love to everyone we meet. In your name we pray, amen. Okay, you guys can head back.
Thank you. Testament reading for today is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say I am only a youth, for to all to whom I send you, you shall go, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." The epistle reading for today is from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 12, verse 31b through chapter 13, verse 13. "But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love."
We rise for the gospel. Holy gospel today comes from the book of St. Luke, chapter 4, starting with verse 31. "Jesus went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and he was teaching them on the Sabbath, and they were astonished at his teaching, for his word possessed authority. And in the synagogue there was a man who had the spirit of an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice, 'Ha, what have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be silent and come out of him.' And when the demon had thrown him in their midst, he came out of him, having done him no harm. And they were all amazed and said to one another, 'What is this word? For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out.' And reports about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. And he arose and left the synagogue and entered Simon's house. Now Simon's mother-in-law was ill with a high fever, and they appealed to him on her behalf. And he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her. And immediately she rose and began to serve them. And when the sun was setting, all those who had any who were sick with various diseases brought them to him. And he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. And many demons also came out of many, crying, 'You are the Son of God.' But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak, because they knew that he was the Christ. And when it was day, He departed and went into a desolate place. The people sought him and came to him and would have kept him from leaving them. But he said to them, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns as well, for I was sent for this purpose. And he was preaching in the synagogues of Judea. Gospel of the Lord.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. Text for today is our letter to Corinthians from St. Paul, particularly these words. So now faith, hope, and love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love. You may be seated. As you may be aware, I actually grew up out here. I attended Denver Lutheran High School, and we actually had chapel every single day when I was in high school. Wednesdays were, the other days were pretty kind of short and devotional-like. Wednesdays was closer to a worship service, though. And on one particular day, my favorite, happened to be my favorite teacher, Glenn Kirch, gave a message on this text. And all the students were supposed to bring their Bibles to chapel, and almost none of them ever did. So he actually printed out this text, and it was close to Valentine's Day. I think that's why he picked the text. So he printed this out on pink and red pieces of paper and handed them all out to us, and he delivered a message that day. And I got to be honest, I don't really remember what he said, but I was moved enough that I actually took that piece of paper, and we had three ring binders for each of the classes, and you could put it had clear plastic in the front, so you could put something, slip something in between, and I slipped that in my school folder, and I kept it there all year, and I would sit in chapel, and I would hold my girlfriend's hand, and I would think about how much I love her, and she loves me, and then it turns out that this text really doesn't have anything to do with romantic love. And so I learned that when I went to seminary. started to learn the Greek language, had professors talk about it. And then I left seminary and I started doing premarital counseling for couples, helping them plan their weddings. And for a couple of years, I was kind of a jerk because people would say, "We want the love passage." And I would be like, "That's not about love between a man and a woman. You shouldn't have that in your wedding." And then by the grace of the Holy Spirit, he kicked me in the butt and I made this realization where I said, but no marriage can survive without also this kind of love. So there's no reason to not have this reading in weddings as well. But the challenge that we actually have before us today is trying to understand this word love, because we use it in all these different ways here, especially in the English language. I mean, think about just, I'm going to tell you a bunch of things I love, and I just want you to think about how diversely I use this word. I love Julie. I love the girls. I love In-N-Out Burger. I love the Denver Broncos and would love to see the Chiefs lose. Now, I've used one word with some things that are really, really important, and if we're honest, some things that are really not that important, right? But we have one word, love, that's used for all of them. And so as I was thinking about this, I had this kind of realization that we do this all the time where we read kind of into the Bible what we think something means. We don't read, let the Bible inform us as much really as we should. And I think this understanding of love is a big one. Now, if you don't believe me about that, you just have to be on social media to know how much people misunderstand the Bible and what God says. For example, wow, that one didn't go over it. Okay, so now, do you guys remember when email first came out? Did you have that friend or relative who would send you the email that said, "If you don't forward this to 25 people, you don't love Jesus"? Did you ever get those? Well, do you remember, I don't know if you know, but it's made its way onto Facebook. Well, time to see who all shared that one post so I know who to bless. There's Jesus on his MacBook. That part might be true, actually. Right? So we have this belief, this understanding about this word, love, and part of the problem, again, is how big that word is. And so here's the thing. I don't know if you know this. Probably every time I do this sermon, I mention this, but that's all right. In the Greek language, they have four words for the word love, right? They have the word eros, that's for erotic love. That's actually never used in the Bible. They have the word storge, that is the love of kind of family, familial love. This is what I picture when I hear my daughter say, "I love you," and because that is what they mean. Because it's the kind of, "I love you, but I could also beat you up in 1 second," right? That's that kind of love. There's philia, from which we get like Philadelphia, right? So it is literally that kind of brotherly love. This is love of, this is like lifelong friendship. This is people you've committed to the same thing. This is love that binds you that way. That's philia love. And then we have this word that is used today. It's called agape. Now, what's interesting about this word, C.S. Lewis, in his book Four Loves, likes to define this word as gift love. He says this is love that goes one direction, from one person to another. In fact, it's sacrificial love. And I told him this at 8 o'clock, and you'll get to decide for yourselves here. I think I'm about to do one of the most arrogant things that I've ever done in my life. I'm about to quote my own sermon. I'm about to quote myself in a sermon from a sermon that I already gave. Does that sound pretty arrogant? Are you with me on that? So on Christmas Eve, we did this theme where I talked about who needs Christmas. And the middle one was, I said, God needed Christmas. And I made this statement that said, true love demands a sacrifice. And I did that because I wanted to start thinking about not only Christmas in a different way, but even when we talk about love. Because the other way we could talk about this word is we could talk about it as sacrificial love. It is love that costs us something. Back in the day when I held my girlfriend's hand and I thought about this text and I was like, "Oh, we love each other," what I really loved is what she gave me, right? And if we're honest, when we're immature, that's kind of our understanding of love. But true love demands a sacrifice, and let's face it, as Americans, we are terrible at this. I mean, in many ways, our entire life revolves around the exact opposite. Your value to me as a person, as a company, as an organization is all about what you can give to me, right? And if you had doubt that in any way, just think about what we've experienced over the last couple of years. I was thinking about this. A friend of mine and I went to eat at this restaurant, and we go in, and the hostess is like, you know, how many? We're like, there's two of us, and we're like, all right. She's like, hold on, it'll be about 10 minutes. And we look, and I'm not kidding you, they've got 50 plus booths and tables. Five of them are occupied, and she says, we have to wait. Well, so we're kind of annoyed, but then we finally get our seat, and she's trying to serve, and kind of getting angrier and angrier. And then all of a sudden, it dawned upon me. I'm like, I'm in this condition because either they can't get enough employees or people didn't show up, and I'm currently angry at the only person who is doing their job right now. I'm not angry at the people who aren't there. My sister was traveling recently, and she got caught in all those flight delays, and hers was, like, delayed till the next day, and she said people were literally screaming at the customer service people, right? And it's sort of like, they're not the ones who didn't show up or, you know, so that the flight can't go or anything like. So I mean, just think, we're so used to having what we want provided to us that it permeates our entire lives. And so when we talk about sacrificial love, it's kind of a challenge. So Paul comes along here. He's been talking to the Corinthians about being united, about sharing their gifts together. In fact, chapter 12, we actually read it, split it up over the last 2 weeks, talked about being united as a body, right? Not everybody's a foot, not everybody's an ear, not everybody's a hand, that sort of thing, but we have to be united working together. And then he ran into this problem that developed, which was even with them knowing that, they started to think that some gifts were better than others, right? Like, sure, everybody has a gift, but some gifts are kind of amazing gifts, right? And some gifts nobody wants, right? And so he talks about it. He's like, you know, he talks about tongues, right? Some people think, oh, it'd be so amazing to be able to speak in tongues. People would be like, whoa, what's going on? Or the gift of prophecy, right? Like, you're such a great speaker, and you're telling the future, and you're doing all these amazing things, right? Or even the gift of faith, right? He talks about his faith to move mountains. And he talks about all of these gifts, and he says none of them actually even matter if you do not have the love that we've been talking about. This sacrificial love, this love that gives of itself. And then he ends the entire thing saying this. Now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Now, I don't know if you ever thought about it, but it's kind of an interesting thing for him to say, especially if you think about how important the other words are, right? Faith, let's start with that one. We actually unpacked this quite a bit in the fall sermon series they did because it's kind of a pet peeve of mine, because in America, Americans, even American Christians, use this word faith incorrectly, right? They talk about, well, you just got to have faith, and as you kind of push back and ask what that means, what you discover they're saying is you have to have faith in faith itself, right? Like, if you believe enough in believing, then something will happen, right? But faith in the Bible has an object, right? Biblical faith is connected to something. We talk about it as the most explicitly as the promises of God. Time and time again, look at Abraham, right? Is commended for his faith, which is not how much he trusts. It's how much he trusts the promises of God. That is biblical faith. Now, I don't know if you know this, that's important. Would you raise your hand if you think faith is important? Yeah, that's kind of important. Hope. Think about the way we use the word hope. It's kind of like the word love. We can say, you know, I hope to meet the man of my dreams, or I hope to get a great job, or I hope the Chiefs lose. But we also will say things like, I hope to see grandma in heaven, right? And hope's also an important word. Hope, in the biblical sense, means this. It's not crossing your fingers. It's saying, I look to something that is not yet realized, confident that it will be. And actually, the more you dive into it in the Bible, it's confident that it will be in the midst of experiencing evidence to the contrary, right? It's finding, it's belief, it's faith again in the promises of God, but knowing that you have something that is your possession, not yet realized, despite your current circumstances. And the hope of the Old Testament people was the promise of the Messiah. The hope of the New Testament is his return. Something that we know is going to happen, something we long for despite the evidence in front of us. And then we have the word love. And Paul goes on to say that faith, hope, and love are the greatest, but only love, or love is the greatest of them all. But he leads into all of that with an interesting saying. I want you to, I don't know if you caught on, he said this. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I'm fully known. That one verse of scripture to me is one of the most terrifying and one of the most comforting in the world. Because if we're honest, there's times where the thought that God knows every single thing about us is terrifying, but also extremely comforting. But in order to unpack what he means about these three words, we have to answer this question. He says, now I see dimly, then I will. When's the then? It's the key to understanding this entire thing. When's then? Do you think? You won't get kicked out if you guess wrong. You can just, anybody? Heaven, somebody said it. Heaven, yeah. Or after Christ returns and restores all things. Then we will know fully even as we're fully known. And so stick with me on this. In heaven, will we need faith? We will not. We'll be in the presence of God experiencing his promises directly. In heaven, will we need hope? There will be no hope in heaven because that which we hoped for is now our present reality. In heaven, will there be love? Yes, there will. So the reason that Paul says the greatest of these, as important as faith and hope are in this world, is that love, think about this, transcends this world. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a thought that actually kind of gives me goosebumps. Love, God's sacrificial love, transcends this world. That which he has done for us through his son Jesus begins in this world and it continues into the next. Now, if you really want to kind of go like, that means by the power of Holy Spirit, when we sacrificially love, we have created something, we have done something that is not figuratively, but literally eternal. God's sacrificial love lived out through us goes on forever. And what that means is it changes how we think about, I don't know, almost anything in life. Now the mother or the father who decides to give up his job, stay home and change diapers, raise kids, this giving of themselves, the sacrificial love, is eternal. The love that we demonstrate, not even outside of our family, to other people, the things that cost us something, right, that we do for other people is eternal. Fifth Sundays of the month, we give to an outside organization. We're gonna give to victims of the Marshall Fire, right? And not just giving them the money. People have invested their time to go and help try to restore those people. They've given of themselves sacrificially to love these people. That is eternal. This next thing I'm going to say, I actually had been planning on saying it in the State of the Church, and I didn't say it at 8 o'clock, but I decided after 8 o'clock that it was worth saying. And so what that also means is this. We tend to, and especially after COVID and all this sort of thing, and I recognize I'm kind of preaching to the choir since you're all here, but we also tend to operate that way from our church. What are the things it's giving me? What are the programs it's got? How great is the band, or how great is the music, or how great is the building, or how great is the parking, or how great are the pews? Oh, we don't have pews anymore. How great are the seats? Whatever it is, right? But our place is supposed to be about sacrificial love. And what that means is, and I know this is contrary to the world we live in, but I'm asking you to think about this. Your engagement in this place, when you do it sacrificially, is eternal. So maybe you're sitting at home and you've been live streaming since we started doing that because you're not comfortable coming out. I can't make those judgments for yourself. Maybe you were life groups and you kind of quit. And your answer to me is, well, I'm getting what I need. I'm here to ask you to consider that you have overlooked that there are people who need you. I can't tell you if what we're offering is something that you need. I believe it is. But what I'm asking you to think about is that you have something other people need. And when we love in this way, sacrificially of ourselves, what God has done in us, which lasts forever, means that that love is also eternal. Amen. I invite you to stand and join us in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated once again. And prior to our time of offering, I just wanted to recognize for our generosity moment some people who helped us a bunch. I don't know if you ever stopped and thought about it. We always do this every year. We thank the Altar Guild and the people who put up all the Christmas decorations and make our sanctuary beautiful. But we don't think about the people who put them away. Now, maybe it's my personal experience at home, but I've come to have a deep love for the second kind of people. I am surrounded by people who are great at getting stuff out, not so much with people who put it away. And so today, I want to really seriously thank Altar Guild, Brenda and Ryan Christman in particular. They got out, decorated all the trees, but they put them all away. Isn't that amazing? So, as God is generous in our lives, we're generous in the lives of others. We worship him with our offering.
Please rise. Continue with our prayers and pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord Jesus, we do thank you that we have the privilege to come before you because of your great love towards us and your sacrifice. That we can now come before you as your dear children, forgiven and cleansed of all of our sins. Pray, Lord Jesus, that your love would not only change how we view you, but also how we view our purpose in this world, our identity, and the way we view others and our relationship to them. But Lord, it would be focused on a giving and a love, that we would give freely as you have given freely to us. We pray for our church family. We pray for especially today, Jason Bergode and family, William Bergode and family, the Brinke family, the Bruno family, Christ the Redeemer Lutheran in Bennett, and Operation Gratitude to deployed soldiers, all those ministries that seek to be tangible reminders of your love to this world. We pray for all the sick and suffering. We remember today, we pray for Sam, who's having pain. The doctors aren't sure what's causing it. We pray for awareness of his cause, that you would bring him healing and restoration. We pray for good test results and healing for Dirk's dad, Lloyd, and also peace for his mom, Linda, as they deal with Lloyd's sickness. We pray for Larry and also Jim, who appear to be fighting for their lives. We pray for comfort and peace and for recovery and strength. Pray for Betty, who's moved to rehab after having COVID. We pray for continual recovery. And also for Jordan's dad, Ed, who suffered a heart attack this weekend. We pray for healing and recovery for him. Any other prayers we bring before you now on the silence of our hearts? All these prayers and the unspoken ones we bring to you, knowing that you are our Lord and our Savior, our perfect, loving Heavenly Father who responds perfectly according to his will. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had broken and given thanks, he gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. See you. You may be seated. We'll bring the communion out to you, and once we all have it, we'll take it together.
You say you are when I'm afraid. You come and still my beating heart. You stay the same. When hope is just a distant thought, you take my pain and you lead me to the cross. What love is this? You gave your for me and made a way for you to know me, and I confess you're always enough for me. You're all I need. You have a sign. I see the scars upon your hands. Hold the truth that when you can't, you always can. I'm standing here beneath the shadow of the cross. I'm overwhelmed that I can kind and open arms. What love is this that you gave your
so you can eat the body of Christ broken for you. So you can drink the blood of Christ poured out for you for your forgiveness. Depart now in his peace, forgiven and free. Amen.
What love is this? You gave your life for me and made a way for me to know you. And I confess you're always enough for me. You're all I need. What love is this? You gave
rise. True body and blood of our Lord and Savior will strengthen and keep you in the true faith and love until life everlasting. Go in his peace. Amen. Receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine on you. Be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
You are not alone if you are lonely. When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We are all the same, in need of mercy, to be forgiven and be free. It's all you've got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For theirs is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
All right, you may be seated once again, and again, wonderful to have you in worship with us. Just a reminder that at noon here today, we'll be doing our summit meeting. I got a couple things to confess. One is, I don't know if you know this, we always did that on the last Sunday of January because it was between the end of the playoffs and the Super Bowl. But the NFL added a 17th week this year, and I didn't take that into account, which is why it's happening today. I apologize. We'll have that fixed by next year. The other thing is we live stream it, and so the reason is noon is our streaming platform has to have a space in between your streaming windows. You can't go back to back. It's like 15 or 20 minutes, I think. And the this streaming window goes to 11:45 in case Mark or PJ are preaching. So in other words, we have to have that 15-minute window before we can start at noon. So sorry if you have to sit around and talk to each other or something like that until then, but we'd love to have you stick around for that. Another thing we're doing, this has been something that's been in the works for a while, coming to fruition. We're looking to have just some other practices and things we've done around here to make sure we're creating a safe environment for everyone. Part of it is just the world we live in. So you'll see lots of new signages up. You'll see in the pews in front of you, there's these emergency cards. This is just in case you have to contact the authorities. You know your address, where you're at, and all those sorts of things. We're also looking to add someone on Sunday morning to our alert team, is what we're calling. This is someone who's going to just actually keep moving throughout a building, checking doors and stuff, making sure people aren't coming in without our knowledge once we begin. Again, just to help keep us safe. So if you want to serve in that area, talk to Sarah in the office. We would be appreciative of it. SOP 101, that is our Get to Know Summit of Peace. It's for the people who will be finishing our new member class, but also transfers from other Lutheran churches. That's two different Sundays in a row, the 20th and 27th. You get all the kind of background on the church, learn about the website and the software and all that kind of stuff. So come out, join us for that if you would. And Alexi has an announcement.
Are you trying to run out the clock so I can't talk about our fundraiser we're doing? Because we're doing a Save It or Shave It fundraiser for Pastor Jacoby's beard. Okay? This all goes to the National Youth Gathering, but you guys as the congregation get to decide whether we shave it off or if he gets to keep it growing. So there's a video on how you can donate we're going to watch.
Hey, what's this fundraiser about?
Well, well, well. Pastor can either shave his beard
or save it.
That's a tough decision. Guess I'm going to have to donate to shave it.
Yep. You can donate by cash, check, or online.
Hey, how much should I donate?
Well, see, if you donate over $50, you can be entered in to win one of our awesome prizes.
Oh, sweet.
No. Donate by February 27th.
And the winner will be announced March 6th during adult Bible study.
Okay, so you have until February 27th to decide if you're on the red team, which is the correct team, which is Shave It, or if you're on the wrong team, which is blue, which is Save It, okay? So make sure you make your donation. Again, you can make that online as well.
All right, so just out of curiosity, this has been kind of fun. Raise your hand if you assume Julie's on the Shave It side. You are actually incorrect. The more of my face that's covered, she prefers that. So just if you vote to shave it, she might be mad at you, but that's, you know, you got to do what you got to do. So help support our hopefully last fundraiser for the National Youth Gathering. We'd be appreciative of it. As always, keep up to date with what's going on here via email, our website, and our various social media. Contact us in the office if you have any needs. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.